Good evening. I hope you'll indulge me for a moment. I went back and forth about whether or not to speak before this particular piece of music or just come out and start the concert. But what you're about to hear is a very powerful musical statement. This evening's theme, as you can tell by the name of the program, In the Name of Love, all three of these pieces have something very much to do with love and different aspects of love. Tchaikovsky in Romeo and Juliet approaches love from the aspect of forbidden love. And Wagner's piece, which we'll talk about a little bit more on the second half, was written as a birthday present for his wife, Cosima. It was actually never meant to be published, but Wagner ran into some financial troubles, and they published the piece and made some money, and they were able to keep their house or something. The Brahms is the biggest piece on the program. And Brahms was, if you will, discovered by the Schumanns. Robert Schumann, the famous composer, and his wife, Clara, who was at the time equally famous for being an incredible pianist. And Brahms developed a deep love for both Robert and Clara. But he fell in love with Clara. And for those of you who don't know, Robert, or Crazy Bob, as my music history teacher used to refer to him, was a wee bit nuts and ended up attempting suicide on several occasions and eventually did lose his life in an asylum, leaving Clara a widow with several small children. And even after this passing of her husband in several years, Brahms could not get her to fall in love with him. So we're looking at, in this symphony, unrequited love. Now, there is a great deal of ambiguity in the piece, whether it's in F major or F minor. And Brahms and his friend Joachim had these little mottos for themselves. Joachim, the great concert violinist, his motto was free but lonely. And in German, those words start with F-A-E. And he used those note names to help write some pieces, to use them as the basis of melodies. Brahms, half-jokingly, responded to Joachim in a letter with his own personal motto, frei aber froh, free but happy, F-A-F. And he uses those three notes to start this symphony. And they become the motto of the entire symphony. There's this constant reoccurrence. Sometimes it's completely veiled and very difficult to hear, and sometimes it's very obvious. First chord that we're going to hear is an F major chord. You better take notes because I'm going to give a test at intermission. It's an F major chord. The second chord is a very unstable chord. It's called a B diminished 7 chord. And in that chord is an A flat, and that's the aber, but. And then we arrive at F major again. And we spend the rest of the symphony oscillating between major and minor and searching for something, searching for that love that Brahms wanted so desperately.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
now we come to the Siegfried Idol. A lot has been written about Richard Wagner. He was, by many accounts, disagreeable and unpleasant, an anti-Semite, and had been known to run out on a check or two in his time. He even hopped a ship to get away from debt collectors. But he loved Cosima. The sun rose and set on her. And on Christmas Day, 1870, she awoke to the sounds of 13 musicians playing an incredibly beautiful piece of music on the grand staircase of their home. Hans Richter, who was a very famous conductor at the time of Wagner's life, prepared the piece for Wagner. The piece is based on several of the themes from Wagner's operas. And of course, their son, Siegfried, was named after the hero of the Ring cycle. But Richter volunteered to rehearse the orchestra for this Christmas morning birthday surprise. And he loved it so much, the piece, that he taught himself to play the trumpet. Now you might ask yourself, that sounds like a non sequitur. He loved the Siegfried Idol so much that he taught himself to play the trumpet. Now the trumpet has about a 9 or 12 bar tune right at the very end. And rather than find the trumpet player to play it, Richter taught himself to play the trumpet so he could participate in the performance on Christmas Day when they gave the piece to Cosima. This piece really is a display of how much Richard Wagner, the gruff, difficult genius, loved and cared for his wife.
Thank you. Thank you.
come to the final piece on the program, Peter Ilyich Tchaikovsky. Some historians do not like his music. The public seems to love it. Of this piece, which he wrote three times because one of the mighty handful, this group of five Russian composers, a man named Mily Balakirev, each time he looked at the score, Tchaikovsky was seeking his approval, and Balakirev says, it's not quite ready yet. And so he rewrites and he rewrites, and we finally receive this piece. We've had unrequited love, and we've had matrimonial love. What we now have is forbidden love in Romeo and Juliet. And on the surface, we equate the story of Romeo with forbidden love. The two Verona lovers, one kills himself, the other follows suit. Families not understanding how to get along in order for these two young people to live a life of happiness. Tchaikovsky was a homosexual in a time when that was considered an extreme abomination, in a country where that was considered an even more extreme abomination. In recent years, some scholars suggest that Tchaikovsky did not die accidentally, but rather was summoned to a court of honor by his contemporaries at the Moscow Conservatory and asked to kill himself before he brought whatever he was supposed to bring upon the Moscow composers. We don't know if this is true or not, but Tchaikovsky certainly understood forbidden love. In fact, in an attempt to join the mainstream, he married. He received a letter from a young lady who was crazy in love with him. She studied in one of his classes at the conservatory. Tchaikovsky later told his brother Modest, when he received the letter, he had no recollection of who she was. A month later, they were married. 2 weeks after that, he fled the house, suffered a nervous breakdown, and went away for a while. So Tchaikovsky understood forbidden love. And the love theme in this piece was hailed by one of the other mighty handful, a man named Nikolai Rimsky-Korsakov, who was no second-rate composer himself. He said that the second theme, the love theme of Tchaikovsky's Romeo and Juliet, is the greatest theme in all Russian music. Period. High praise for somebody who came, coming from somebody who wrote a few catchy tunes himself. Happy to present to you our final selection for the evening and for the season, Tchaikovsky's Romeo and Juliet.
Thank you.